Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of the Post podcast, where I talk to creative minds about their inspiring professional journeys. I'm your host, David Gidali. This is episode 28, and my guest today is Hugo Guerra. Right?
Yeah, yeah. Well, in Portuguese, it's just Hugo Guerra. That's how we call it. But most people call me Guerra. Just call me Hugo. It's easier. It's simpler.
Hugo, you're a director and a visual effects supervisor. You have over 20 years of experience. You were head of Nuke Department at Mill back in 2012, or I don't know, for many years. And now, I think for the past 6 years, correct me if I'm wrong, you've kind of opened up a new venue or a new trajectory in your career, which is, you know, you became an online persona, basically an influencer and a teacher online. And you have a great following on YouTube and a Patreon page, and you have Kickstarter campaigns for courses that you're delivering, and your Twitch stream, which I'm dying to hear about because I'm not huge on Twitch. I actually, one of the first, maybe going to check out, you know, what you do there is probably one of the first times I went on Twitch. So I'm curious to hear what's that all about. And you've also made a transition from working at a company to working from home remotely and leading a remote team. So I think, and a lot of my listeners, I'm sure, would appreciate hearing about your trajectory and what led you there. I would love to start just hearing, you know, your background before you even started, or how you got into visual effects in the first place, and also kind of understand what made you decide all those things, you know, in your professional journey. Feel free to start at the top or wherever you want, and we can just have a conversation.
First of all, David, thank you so much for inviting me to the podcast. Big fan of your podcast, and thank you so much for inviting me. I feel very honored and very humbled by being on your podcast. Thank you so much.
Thank you. I can't believe half what you're saying, but
it's true. It's true. I never lie. You'll see that on my conversation. So,
oh yeah, I know.
I've been working for a long time. Yes, that is true. All those things you said is true. Like I recently did a big shift. I left the Mill. I was head of Nuke and VFX supervisor at the Mill for 5 years. I left in exactly 5 years ago. Wow. It was actually roughly 5 years ago that I left. Before I even talk about what's happening now and what I've done in the last decade, you're asking me how I got into this. Like it's very linked to my life back in Portugal. You know, I'm Portuguese originally. I was born in Porto and I lived in Lisbon for a long time. It kind of goes back to my fascination in movies. You know, I've always had a video camera. Even back in the day, the video cameras, the video 8 cameras, you know, the really old ones. And so even when I was like 16 and I was like 15, I was already filming things. I was already using my camera and taking photos and things like that. And I got quite fascinated by visual effects, the early ones. You know, of course, they're mostly special effects, not really visual effects. You know, early. Right. Films of Steven Spielberg and early films of Stanley Kubrick and all those kind of things, like, really made, especially Stanley Kubrick, really influenced me going into kind of some kind of filmmaking in some way. You know?
And you're talking about optical special effects, right? Like,
Because when I started, like, when I, like, we're talking about the 90s, you know, the 90s doesn't, you know, I didn't have a computer until kind of 99. That was the first time I had a computer. Even before that, I was filming and editing on video to video. You know, we would have two VCRs with like a control jog shuttle, and then you would edit video to video. That was very common back then. I come from that time, you know. But I think mostly the cinema work of Stanley Kubrick was the biggest influence for me to go into filmmaking in some capacity. And back then, you know, I went and I kind of like, you know, went to like an internet coffee. People don't probably understand this, but back in the day, you would have to go to a place to go to the internet. So I would go to an internet coffee and I would like look up these companies that I saw in the credits of the films, you know, like ILM, what is this? Industrial Light and Magic, Digital Domain, what is this? So I would go and search these companies and see, okay, where are they? What do they do? And then I would kind of like look at their requirements, you know, and I will never forget, like, I was like 17 or 16 and I looked at ILM, looked at the mill, and looked at I think it was Digital Domain already. I can't remember that. But especially ILM, I'll never forget that I went to their requirements and it said, for you to be an artist there, you have to have an art degree. Because back then there was no visual effects courses. You know, you couldn't really do a course about visual effects. So they actually asked for a fine art degrees, you know, so that you would actually have fine arts. And that's what I did. Like, I saw that they were always asking for fine arts. So I went to fine arts. So I took a degree in Portugal, a university degree in arts, where, you know, I learned how to draw, I learned how to do sculpting, I learned how anatomy works, I learned about color, photography, lighting. And it was a 5-year degree, and it was like a master's in arts. And that was kind of like my first step. And at there, while I was at school, I dabbled a lot on video art. I would do short films. I would do music videos for friends. I would do like a lot of little videos. I didn't really knew what I was doing, for sure. You know, but I was using my cameras, and I was like using video to video. And then I kind of like started doing like these short films with friends. And especially, there was one that kind of like became very big in Portugal. You know, I started like, we did like a ninja film, which was the first ninja film in Portugal. And
this was how like many, really, sorry, really, I'm just curious, yeah. What's the population in Portugal? How many people live there?
There's only 9 million people, yeah.
Okay, so, okay, so, I can relate. So, it's kind of, yeah. You know, it's just a small country.
So yeah, that ninja film became quite big, you know, like we did it while I was still at university. We used like analog cameras with video 8. I then had my first computer, so we did a couple of shots in After Effects and a couple of shots in Premiere. This was like After Effects 3 and Premiere 1 and Premiere 2.
How did you take the footage from their camcorder to the computer? Did you have like a FireWire thing?
You know, yeah, I had a video card. So I was one of the first people on the school to buy. I had a Matrox video card.
Oh,
it was called the Matrox RT2000 because it was supposed to be mini DV in real time. It was really crap, you know. It captured in 420, you know, so it was like the quality was abysmal. But yeah. I thought it was great back then. But yeah, we did this ninja film. It was quite big. It actually ended up being broadcasted on TV, which was quite a surprise for us as well.
How long was it?
It was an hour long, but it became like a cult film in Portugal, you know. So it was broadcasted on TV. It had like an audience of 3 million people watching.
Did you direct it, or?
I did. I directed it and filmed it and everything. So that was kind of like my first big thing in Portugal. It's a really crappy film. It's a B movie. It's like almost like an American Ninja film, you know, like it's horrible. But it was like my first thing, you know. I was 18, you know. That was like the first thing I did, and it became
quite big. And it got seen. Yeah, that's pretty remarkable.
Yeah, it got seen. Yeah, exactly. But I think that was the first moment where I started playing around with After Effects, playing around with Premiere, you know, playing around with all these little things. I kind of like started learning by myself. There was no YouTube, you know, you couldn't really learn anywhere. So I had to like learn it by myself. And then I just started understanding that I can't really live from doing short films. I can't really live from video art. So I started doing commercial work. You know, I started doing like, you know, corporate videos. I started doing like commercials for local TV. Became like a cameraman for a local TV station. Like I started kind of doing those kind of extra jobs. And slowly but slowly, like I started building a little portfolio, a little showreel, you know. Started then getting jobs, more complicated jobs in motion graphics, more complicated jobs in visual effects. To a point that then, you know, at some point I kind of felt that Portugal wasn't really big enough for what I wanted to do. Because
and your visual effects work and stuff, these are softwares that you picked up yourself. I mean, I'm assuming with only traditional art background, you had to teach yourself everything.
So it was like I had to learn by looking at the help file and looking at the few tutorials that were out there in DVDs. And there was a couple of magazines launching a couple of things. That was the minimum. Like there used to be a couple of magazines that had a lot of tips and tricks. And it was just like trial and error. You know, you would try things, and then if it didn't work, you would do it again. I think that was kind of like, that was kind of the way I did it, you know. And
there was no tutorials online.
No.
On YouTube.
After Effects was definitely my first thing, you know, like After Effects was my big thing, my first one.
Yeah.
But yeah, I quickly understood that Portugal was not the place, because remember, I was very obsessed with ILM. I was very obsessed with the mill.
Right.
I really wanted to work at the mill. So that was one of, because I loved their commercials, you know, back in the day. and also the work they did on Gladiator.
What's a commercial that strike? Do you remember like one of the first things you saw from the mill?
Those commercials they have from every time they had the World Cup every year. Would have these massive commercials. I remember very clearly this commercial where the players were fighting against devils from hell.
With dust and stuff, I think.
Exactly. And then I think Ronaldo shoots the ball and then the devil breaks down or something like that.
Yeah.
So I'll never forget those commercials, and I kind of went and tried to see where they came from, you know. And they were all coming from the mill. And back then, this was 99 when the mill won the Oscar for the Gladiator, which was also a big thing back then.
Yeah.
You know, so I left Portugal. I left Portugal. I couldn't really go to Britain because... back then, early year 2000s, I had a lot of pets. You know, I had three cats and one dog, and you couldn't come to Britain without doing quarantine, like 2 months quarantine with the pets.
Oh, really?
I didn't really wanted my pets to go through that horrible ordeal, so I kind of like started sending my show reel everywhere. And this is the biggest advice I'll give to anyone watching here, that if they want to work in visual effects. I didn't send my show reel to two or three places. I sent my show reel to literally hundreds of places. And this was a VHS tape and a DVD for some places that accepted the DVD, of course.
Yeah.
There was no online presence, so you couldn't really send a Vimeo link. That didn't exist. So,
a lot of energy is sending all that out. And
oh, yeah. I would go to the post office and I would send like 20 at a time. You know, it was very expensive as well. I had to like make the DVDs. I would have to print the DVDs, you know, and send it over. And then I got like five or six responses, you know, a couple of companies in Germany, a couple of companies in Sweden. I sent it all over Europe, and I ended up getting hired through Skype. You know, I had a Skype call. It wasn't Skype. Sorry, it was Hotmail. It wasn't Hotmail. It was Messenger or whatever.
Yes.
Yeah, Skype didn't exist yet. So we did the call, and they liked me, and they liked my showreel, so they hired me. So I ended up going to Sweden to work as an After Effects artist on this kind of animation studio called Animec, which doesn't exist anymore. So I went there, spent a few years there, worked as an After Effects artist for a while, then kind of started working as an art director on that company as well. We did a lot of corporate films. We did a lot of music videos. And then finally the quarantine closed in Britain, you know, and it wasn't necessary to have quarantine anymore. As soon as that happened, I just moved immediately to Britain, you know. And that was already, that was 12 years ago when I moved to Britain. After spending many years as an art director on that company in Sweden. While I was on that company, I was already starting to like direct at least the artistic side of things, and I was already getting quite a few awards. I was already getting a lot of projects there going. So when I went to Britain, you know, then I became a freelancer like most people are in Britain. Like I started jumping from company to company, really. Working as a compositor at Nexus, you know, working as a compositor at Jellyfish Pictures, you know, working as a compositor at the Mill as well as a freelancer. And also did some work for the BBC. Just would jump around from studio to studio as a compositor. Yeah.
What's the life of a compositor like? I mean, I have a lot of friends who do it, but I personally rarely have ever like worked. I mean, besides it, in the studio that I kind of grew up in, you know, quote unquote, haven't actually had the opportunity to see different studios and different pipelines. Like, so
yeah.
Kind of curious what. I'm sure you learn a lot, and every studio does things a little bit differently. Or is there a sort of unified kind of workflow that you found between those studios?
Yeah, I mean, definitely they're very different. You know, some of them would be much more focused in 2D, others much more focused in 3D, and they would have their own tools, their own pipelines. You know, give an example, like at Nexus, for example, most of it was based in 3D Studio Max and V-Ray and Nuke comping and doing 3D. And they had like a Windows-based workstations. So the pipeline was running on Windows. They had a Windows server. Everything was running on Windows. I think it was Vista or something like that.
Yeah.
And this was like early 2010s or something like that when I did that. And then, for example, at the opposite spectrum, the Mill has a complete Linux-based pipeline. And they literally, the whole company was running XSI at the time. That was their main render engine. They did some Maya with Mental Ray, but Then, of course, when XSI was killed off, like unfortunately, company kind of shifted. The company kind of shifted quite a lot to Houdini, and they were the first company to use Arnold as well in production. So we Arnold. We were using Arnold Beta. It wasn't even a version. So the mill has like a very dedicated pipeline where there's a complete folder structure construction. There's a complete management of shots. There is a complete, very set in stone naming convention, which you can't even deviate. It doesn't even let you deviate.
Right, right. If you, it's like everything is automated. Wrong,
yeah, everything. If you type something wrong, it just doesn't let you. You know, so yeah. So it's a very different aspect from Nexus, which is much smaller and much different. You know, but yeah, like that's kind of like I started working through these companies. I think I'll say one thing to the audience. Like, I think I was incredibly lucky because I think I arrived in London. This was in 2008 when I arrived. This was exactly the perfect moment for me to arrive, you know, because the companies were just about to finish off with Shake. You know, I was using Shake in Sweden for a while. Shake, for those of you who don't know, it's the visual effects compositing application before Nuke. It was like earlier. It was actually from a company called Nothing Real, and then it was purchased by Apple, and then Apple kind of killed it off.
Yeah.
So Shake was the biggest thing in London, really, and I was using Nuke in Sweden because Sweden companies usually tend to buy the latest tech. So they bought Nuke right away when it was available. So I started using Nuke with Nuke 4. I've been using Nuke now for 16 years, you know. So, sorry, 15 years. So I was very lucky because I was doing production in Nuke for 3 years already when I came to London. And when I got to London, no one used Nuke, you know. No one knew Nuke. Everyone was just using Shake. And then Apple killed Shake. And then the rug was taken out of the legs of everyone. And everyone's like desperate to start shifting everything to Nuke. And hardly anyone knew Nuke, you know.
Yeah.
So I was like in the perfect place because then I was one of the few people that had a lot of experience with Nuke, I started then being hired as a teacher to teach Nuke at Skype. I started becoming a freelancer everywhere to go through companies and kind of show them how to implement Nuke. I was one of the few because, you see, Nuke, before it was sold by the Foundry, the only way for you to use Nuke was if you worked at Digital Domain. And so anyone else that didn't work at Digital Domain, they would never be able to even have access to the software. So I think I was incredibly lucky to arrive at the city exactly in that time. And that's kind of why they hired me as the head of Nuke, because I was one of the few artists that had extensive experience in compositing because of After Effects and Shake, but also knew Nuke, you know. So then it became, when I came into the mill, a lot of people were still using Shake, so we kind of transitioned the company into Nuke and you know, and kind of build the department, because when I got there, the department was only like 5 or 6 people, and ultimately it grew to like 30 people, that department, you know. It became much bigger, you know.
So I'm curious, just because it's a good tip for people who are starting out now, to kind of my take on it is basically what you're saying is it's always good to like look around, try to find new tools that maybe are not widely used, and maybe you're going to ride kind of a new wave with that tool, and that can help you kind of, do you still look around yourself and like try to look for new tools, or do you have any
I think there's two sides of this coin. Like first of all, I think people should really become like, let me put it this way. Like, I think everyone should be much more software agnostic than they are. And I think that's one of the key features of being an artist these days. Especially now after working for 20 years, I feel like I'm completely agnostic. I can really try to use anything. And I think that's my approach to everything. You know, if I need to open After Effects, I do. If I need to open Fusion, I do. If I need to open Nuke, I do. If I need to open any other application, that's fine. Because the important thing people need to understand is that knowing the software is just a little piece of it, you know, like clicking around is so easy, and you can really teach anyone to click around. What you can teach very easily, which is harder to teach, is to do a good shot, or to do good lighting, or to do a good composition.
Exactly.
So for me, like I kind of like rode the wave that I think came from my art background, you know, becoming, because I had a fine arts degree as a master's, like I felt like I knew a lot about composition, color. I knew a lot about like how to make a good image, and I knew a lot about photography. And that really has helped on my career. So obviously, I feel like people should focus on those core aspects of their career. They should Right. focus on learning color instead of spending too much time learning the shortcuts of Maya. You know, so I think those are the key things. You know,
totally.
No, but having said that, what happened to me was incredibly lucky because the usually softwares don't really change that much, but Nuke was really a turning point, you know, because before Nuke, you had After Effects, and After Effects is a layer-based compositor, and Nuke is a node-based compositor, and the philosophy of working has really shifted with Nuke. When you had Shake, which was also noded, and then you had Nuke with nodes as well, it really changed the dynamic of how to operate and how to make a shot and how to experiment in visual effects. It's a very experimental application. So I think not only I was lucky because I learned Nuke very early on, but I think I was lucky because I was doing node compositing. I think it could have happened any other way. If it was Shake, it would have been also the same. If it was Fusion, it was already the same. I think the shift had happened from layer to nodes, and that's when that shift happened around the early 2000s, you know, and I think I was very lucky. But to answer your question, I definitely think people need to look around for the new techniques and way of working, for sure. For example, I'll give an example. Right now, I am incredibly excited with Unreal 5, and I'm incredibly excited to see how Unreal 5 is kind of going to potentially change the landscape, not the software, you know, because Unreal 5 is just another 3D application.
Right.
What changes with Unreal 5 is the speed of iteration, which I think will change the industry forever, where you will have more time to create a really awesome shot because you don't have to wait for the renders. And you can actually iterate faster and faster. So for me, I'm not saying people should look into Unreal 5 specifically, but I definitely think people should be looking into real-time engines, you know, and even if they don't look at real-time engines, they should be looking at GPU accelerated engines so that they can at least do it faster. You know, that's for example why I've chosen on my company, I use Redshift, I don't use Arnold, you know, because I just prefer to be faster, I prefer to have iterations.
I use Octane, so I mean,
yeah, I use Octane, so it's the same kind of principle.
And I think Redshift is probably the next thing for
I think Redshift, I see it popping in and out everywhere, and I think it is truly getting there, and it's truly starting to become a competition to Arnold, really, to be honest. But Unreal is really bringing things into another spectrum, of course. But I think I guess maybe it will never happen again, what happened to me, but I feel like if you are always on the cusp and always looking around yourself and seeing what is the next possible big thing, it is important for you because there are so many artists, you know, there's so much competition. So even if you know the software really well, you also have to have some luck.
Yeah.
It's not just being a good artist. It's also being lucky and being in the correct place, I think, as well. That helps a lot as well.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing I wanted to add is, like, you know, I came from a different background. I have a warm place in my heart for people who start from the tools as opposed to starting from the craft or from the foundations, like the art foundations. So I never went to art school until after I was already proficient in at least one or two softwares. And I know how, you know, people get motivated by different things. I feel like if I had started with the fundamentals of art, I probably would have been, well, it depends on my teachers, of course, and, you know, the experience that I had, but I might have been bored a lot faster. You know, I might have, like, been sort of just kind of fed up with physical materials, you know, really want to sit in the computer and start to, like, because I also started, you know, looking at Steven Spielberg films, you know, Jurassic Park and Terminator 2, and seeing all those amazing visual effects. That was kind of what drew me in the first place. And by the time I started to study it, I was, I guess, a bit younger than you. So I already had a computer, and I had a 3D software at my disposal, of course, a pirated copy when I was like 12 years old or 14 years old. So the tools were there right in front of me. And it took me probably about 8 years after, you know, later, that I basically was like, you know, maybe I should actually, study a little bit about the fundamentals, you know, the art rules and stuff. And I can't stress how important that is and how much of a difference it is when someone actually knows those things versus not knowing and just knowing how to use the tool. Of course, it's
I know. And that's the thing. Like, there's nothing wrong with doing it later. Nothing wrong with that at all. Like, I think it doesn't really matter if you do it before or after.
Yeah.
I did it before because back then on my time, there was no other way. Like, most companies would force you to have an art degree. That doesn't happen anymore. You know, no company now has on the requirements that you have a art degree. That doesn't exist anymore. That kind of ended in the early 2000s. But learning, like, I say this to my students all the time, like, and also to my artists, even at the mill, I used to say this. I would see a lot of talented artists really knowing how to do a shot, but then they would fail miserably at bokeh or depth of field, or they would fail miserably at composition, or not noticing the shadows were wrong. And I was like, oh, come on, man. You don't know anything about shadows. You don't even know. Or people would ask, oh, what is this f-stop thing? What is this? Like, I just feel to me, like, personally, that is really a big, big problem in the industry. And I feel if you are a person that is doing lighting, or if you're a person that's doing compositing, if you're finishing any shot, either you're a lighter, a compositor, or a colorist, you know, you need to know photography, because that's what we're doing. Like, you're in the 3D application mimicking a camera, trying to mimic what the camera does, trying to mimic what the lens does, trying to mimic the movement. If you don't have any understanding of how f-stops works, or shutter speeds works, or even a camera weight works, or even what a dolly camera is, or what a steadicam is, if you don't know any about that, like, how are you going to make the shot look real? You're never going to make it real. You know? So I think it's incredibly important for people to do that. And it's funny that lately, every 2 weeks I do a stream on Twitch about that, about the best books that I would recommend for visual effects artists. So I've done two streams. I'm doing the first stream this weekend. And I am now on chapter one, which is photography books. And then chapter two will be visual effects books. So I'm kind of going through, I have hundreds of books of visual effects, of color, of both from my university time, but also books I bought now from cinematographers, from directors, from all sorts of people. And every time I do this stream, like, I always have like a couple of hundred people watching the stream, and there's always so many people on the chat asking, why do I have to read books? Book? I just want to know Maya. Like, why do I have to read the book? And I was like, okay, you're not getting it. You're not getting it, mate. Like, you know Maya, it will be pointless if you know Maya. Right. Because once Maya goes away and something else comes along, what are you going to do then? Yep. You know, that's the problem. That's the issue. Like, if people don't understand those core fundamental skills, they will never be able to navigate to another software. That's the key, you know. It's for you to learn those things so that you can just easily, because learning the software is easy. That's the easy part of all of this, you know.
Yeah, well, and I think people need to also, every person is in a different place in their journey, and they need to understand that even though it's hard right now, once you've sort of climbed that hill and you topped that, that obstacle, looking back, it's not going to seem that hard. And it's going to be, you know, you're going to be a little less heavy on your feet, you know, like, it really is. I remember I was on 3D Studio Max for many, many years. I'm still using it as my main kind of 3D tool. And I use After Effects. And even though I played around with Nuke, I've always wanted to transfer, but because I'm working alone and I do a lot of motion graphics, it's kind of, After Effects always seems to be my my easy fallback, plus all the plugins that I already have that, you know, it's like...
Of course.
You know, excuses, I know, but...
No, it's not excuses at all. Like, I've been on your situation. You know, when I decided to shift to Nuke, it took me forever, and I just kept trying Nuke and also Shake, and I was like, no, I'm going to just go back to After Effects. And I would keep doing this. It was only, ultimately, it was when I made the decision, okay, this is a project I have to do. I'm going to uninstall After Effects. And I did that. I uninstalled After Effects. And I said, I'm not going to install it, and I'm going to finish this job. And I did. It was incredibly painful. I spent a month hitting with my head against the wall. But I've learned Nuke so much more on that month than I've tried for months and months and before. And after a while, after a few months, I never open Nuke again, After Effects again. You know. So I think it's... If you really want to shift to another application, just need to force yourself into it and uninstall it from the computer.
Yeah. My way of doing that with Maya and also Nuke was actually to hire, because I already got to the point where I was hiring other artists and other studios to help me with jobs. And I just decided to hire a Maya studio, for instance, for like some previous job that I did. And I forced myself to basically, I had to be able to open Maya and do, you know, do changes and do revisions and help them and stuff. So of course I don't know how to model in Maya and I don't know how to do all these like specific tasks, but I know how to open a scene and move the camera around and create keyframes and, you know, play with a track editor. And same thing with Nuke. I worked with, it's funny because I know you were working with Trey sometimes in India. I think you mentioned out there.
I worked a lot with them at the mill, of course, because the mill used to just use Trace for every single thing that they would roto. And I did travel a few times. Yeah, I did. So
they use Nuke, and you know, sometimes. But I also work with other studios that also use Nuke solely for compositing. So I know enough to be able to open a script on my computer and reverse engineer it and do, you know, small changes here and there. But it's a totally different beast when you have to start a shot on your own, of course. Yeah.
But it's funny, like we were discussing this thing about the core skills and about extra stuff like artistic and photography. Another thing I would say to the audience here is that the reason also why you want to learn those extra things is because, think about this, like, are you really going to become if you've decided to be a compositor, let's say that you decided to be a compositor, or you decided to be a lighting artist, are you going to be a lighting artist or a compositor until you're 70? Because that's probably not going to happen. So you need to kind of start thinking in a more broad stroke, you know, like, I'm the only reason why I became a VFX supervisor at the mill, and the only reason why I am a VFX supervisor at Sony, and I've done VFX provision for Ubisoft, I've done VFX provision for Fire.Smoke, for a bunch of companies as an on-set supervisor. The only reason I did that was because of my knowledge of photography and cameras and lenses, and because of all the extra knowledge, and knew a bit of 3D and knew a bit of lighting. That extra knowledge is the one that is going to give you access to other job opportunities and also evolve as an artist, because if you just stick with one single thing, chances are you're going to be doing it for a very long time. And I'm not saying there's a plan. You know, I don't really have a plan. You know, I'm just like learning as I go, and I kind of keep learning new and new things. And who knows where I'm going to end up in a couple of years. You know, right now I've been mostly working as a director for cinematics and games, and I've been mostly been on set doing things, but maybe in 5 years I'll be, you know, in Unreal, or maybe in 10 years I'll be doing something else. It is a very changing landscape, and learning new treats and new techniques is really something that can not only make your career fresh, but also allow you to evolve and to grow. Because if you're even in a company, if you don't know new things, you'll never grow inside of it. You'll never become a lead, or you'll never become a sequence lead, and then you will never become a supervisor. And
yeah,
that's the thing, you know. So
I mean, I remember when I was working at an animation company, I actually applied to two schools because I was 25 and I felt like I hit a glass ceiling. I was already a CG supervisor at the company. I built their pipeline. I was, you know, working together with directors on we were working on an animation series at the time. And I felt, okay, the next thing I want to do is just direct. And I've tried a few times within the company to get some directing jobs, to do some original shorts that we, you know, in animation. And it just kept hitting that glass ceiling where it's just there's always something more important going on. There's always these external projects and external deadlines and stuff. So I decided to go to school, and I applied to art school for animation. And then I didn't get in. They didn't accept me for some reason. but I was, it was almost a blessing, because I was like, well, actually I kind of want to do something completely different. And for me, something completely different at that point was to study filmmaking, because it had nothing to do with animation, nothing to do with, well, you know, at that point when you went to film school, there was no relation to animation, with the exception that it's the same thing, only different techniques. But film school basically had only, the closest thing it had was an editing department. But getting into film school really opened up this amazing kind of new track in my brain for exactly what you're talking about, you know, to think about lenses and think about the practicalities of making, you know, it kind of trickles into everything you do in 3D when you realize, you know, cameras, they have weight and they move in a certain way. And even though And even though nowadays a lot of films kind of threw that out of the window because they have the ability to move the camera around and, you know, weightlessly and do all those things, you know, I still feel like it's sort of, you know, subtextually, when you watch a film and you feel like the camera has weight to it, you know, it makes you appreciate the film better, you know, or something.
But you see, I actually think that it's actually going backwards again, because if you think about it, like the way, and this is also because of most of the visual effects supervisors in the industry right now, they are very big fans of actual reality and not just random cameras like we used to have on the year 2000s. I do think we're going quite backwards now. Not backwards in a bad way, but in a good way. Like, people are now very adamant about weight of lenses. They're very adamant about, if we're going to move a camera, it's going to be on a dolly, you know?
Right.
It's going to be like on tracks, you know? If we're going to move a camera, it's going to be an actual, a physically accurate tripod, you know?
Yeah.
Like, that's happening a lot. Most visual effects companies have built rigs, complete replicas of rigs of cameras, you know, because they've had like workshops with cinematographers, they had workshops with camera people, which is excellent, you know, and that's why you see so much realism in cinema. And if you look back at the last 4 or 5 Oscars for visual effects, you start really seeing that in the Oscars. You know, you start seeing, okay, last time it was First Man, which is a complete photoreal depiction of the Apollo moon landing, and it has nothing but realism. DNEG just made like it's perfect. If you look back a year before, Ex Machina, like a perfect, accurate photoreal robot walking around with clothing and with skin and everything. You know, if you look back, you know, realism is a big thing now. And even if you look at, you know, backwards projection, like you see on The Mandalorian, you saw it also in First Man as well. We're kind of like going full circle. We are actually starting to go a bit back into what we used to do before, you know, which was more based in reality than everything else, because, you know, back projection was real. There was a person there. There was a car there. There would be projections around the person so that you would have lighting interactions and everything. And now, of course, obviously, we've updated the technology of back projection with really good, like, you know, panels with like 5,000 lumens and like things like that, so that you can actually have pure HDR backgrounds instead of just like the normal ones. And I think that's really going to change the industry forever. And that's why you're now seeing those Oscars for First Man, those Oscars for, you know, Ex Machina. Those films are now starting to go into a new phase where I think photorealism is starting to happen. But photorealism can only really happen when you start making things in 3D, compositing and CG and everything in lighting accurate. That means you're replicating everything. And this is happening not even just on full CG realistic films, even on animation, you know. Last year when I was on an event, I met Eric Smith, which is a director of photography at Pixar.
Right.
And we had dinner together. He was doing a talk after me, and he also recently did another talk on Twitch, which I saw. And if you look at his talks and you look at his work that he's done with Incredibles 2 and the work that he's done there, you can kind of see that everything he does is based in reality. Everything he does is based on weighted cameras. And even as he has even built inside of the 3D applications they use at Pixar, they even build like flaps and reflectors. And even like, you know, when you put in front of the lights, you put these kind of like little rigs of wires and cut pieces so it disperses the light. He literally built an entire kit set from a director of photography, you know, with C-stands, with black flags, with the reflectors, silver reflectors, gold reflectors, little pointed lights. He's basically trying to mimic what usually you do on set.
Right.
And it's incredibly nice to watch. Like, if you look at Incredibles 2, it just looks, of course, it's still an animation. It's not supposed to be photoreal, but it has all that kind of world of real lighting and photography that really brings it up. You know, it makes it so beautiful.
And I'm sure he takes like the whole lighting department and kind of runs them through like practical cinematography workshops and stuff. Because I mean, I think that was one of the things that was so missing in my initial experience, was like just being on set and seeing how cinematographers work. And even when I was in my first film school in Israel, you know, they had a pretty decent cinematography program, but when I came to LA and I studied at AFI, that was like a game changer. just you know, seeing how they do everything and having, you know, real name cinematographers come in and give us workshops and seeing that. In a way, even though I studied directing, not cinematography, I feel like I've learned a lot more in the from the cinematography students that that went there.
Absolutely. I mean, that's what I really want to emphasize. Like, anyone that wants to be a lighter, they need to be a cinematographer. You know, that's the thing. Like, that is so crucial. And you start seeing this popping up everywhere. You know, look at Pixar, look at DreamWorks, look at Blur. They have directors of cinematography. You know, they have DOPs. Obviously, these are digital DOPs, but they are DOPs nonetheless, you know.
Yeah. So, but, and you also, you had this kind of early break as a director somehow that you didn't expect to have when you were 18. Did you ever think of like doing a full transition into being like getting off the box, you know, being outside, being on set?
What's you mean to become a director full time? You mean?
Yeah. Have you ever thought of that? Or
I have, of course, but I think obviously, you know, it's a bit like what I said before. There's luck and there's also bad luck as well. I think that I was in one way, I was lucky that I was pretty sufficient in visual effects, and I was lucky to be in the correct place in the correct time and became really kind of big in the visual effects industry, especially after being at the mill for so long. And that also became my downfall, because obviously the more you work in these companies, the less you do for yourself, you know? And that's one of the reasons I left, because I kind of, like, I was directing in Portugal. I was doing music videos. They were crappy things, you know. It was crappy music videos and crappy films, but at least it was my thing, you know.
Right.
And I was kind of building it up. But then when I went to Sweden, I kind of stopped doing it because I couldn't. I didn't have time. I had to be at the company the whole time.
Right.
And when I came to freelancing in London, I didn't have the time. The only moment I had the time was there was a moment that I convinced some of my colleagues at the mill to do the 48-hour challenge in London, you know, so that we would do a short film in 48 hours.
Right.
Which, by the way, do not do. It's the most horrible thing in the world to do something in 48 hours.
Yeah.
It's horrible. It almost killed me. Anyway, so I kind of like, you know, decided to leave the mill. But obviously, there's always this balance. You know, I'm not rich. I come from a very poor background. You know, I can't really sustain myself, or my family can sustain me while I pursue a director's career. That's really not going to happen, you know. A lot of people are lucky to have families that can support them, and they can kind of like do pilots and do directions and do those things. I never really had that luck. And so because I had to work for a living and really pay the bills, I kind of started doing, you know, I left the mill because I wanted to direct more. Started directing trailers and started directing little cinematics and started directing like little TV commercials. And obviously that's not really directing because that's not film. You know, I'm not doing a film, but I still have my eye on the prize. You know, I'm still doing my short films. I've directed a short film a couple of years ago, which I'm still finishing right now.
Oh, cool.
I have a new short film up and coming as well. And I'm slowly getting there, but obviously my life has changed so much now, especially with YouTube and with Twitch and with my streamings and my teaching as well, which kind of like, or now I'm on the phase now that kind of have to make a decision. Okay, should I pursue this thing of doing commercials and direct those kind of things in a professional way? And maybe if I'm lucky, it's a one in a million chance, maybe I'll do a film, you know, that's kind of the way I see it. Especially because I don't live in Hollywood, I don't live in LA, I live in London. So it's obviously it's going to be even harder to become a director if you don't live in LA. Everyone always telling me this, oh, if you want to be a director, you have to be in LA. Okay, well, I don't want to go to LA. but that's fine. Like, you know, so I'm kind of on a crossword. I'm like, okay, should I pursue this more and do a short reel of directing of what I've done so far? Because I do have quite a lot of jobs that I've won awards and everything. You know, I had like, I directed the in-game cinematics of Homefront. I directed Vermintide. I directed a bunch of really cool cinematics, and I'm sure I can do a showreel. But because of all the work I'm doing online now on YouTube, on Kickstarter, on Twitch, I'm kind of seeing maybe a second chance for me. I'm kind of seeing, okay, maybe what I should do is actually do short films for my online platforms.
Yeah.
Because I kind of look at this, you know, I have all the equipment myself. I have lenses, I have cameras.
Oh, I can
you can see some of them on the background here. I have quite a lot of equipment myself. It's very pro-consumer equipment. Obviously, I don't have a red camera. I don't have, like, pro-consumer. But it's material enough. I have, enough lenses, enough cameras, and enough equipment to do what I want, which is like, you know, some cool short films and some film sequences. And that's kind of what I'm kind of debating now. Maybe what I'm going to do is I'm going to start doing more Kickstarters. I'm going to, since they were so successful, I had three of them already. Maybe I'm going to start doing more shots for my students. And then at the same time, I can do the shots for my students, but I also can do my own films. And that kind of started a few years ago. I used to be a teacher on a in a school in Sweden called Campus I-12. I was teaching there for 10 years in and out while I was at the mill as well. So I would travel there and teach there. And it's kind of started there, like where every year they had to do a project, a final project with the whole class. You know, we were 30 people. And it started there. Like I filmed two short films with them, you know, which was nice experience. Yeah. It was a nice experience because I directed the short film, did the script, and then they did the VFX and I did the editing. Like we kind of worked together as if it was a real company. Yeah. And I feel like I really loved that. It was so enjoyable to do those films. And I kind of feel like maybe I should dust off my scripts and actually film them with the equipment I have, with the actors I know and the people I know here in London. Obviously, now I can't film anything because no one can leave the house. But once we can leave, maybe I should do those things. And then that becomes material for my online courses. It becomes material for my YouTube channel. And then I'm happy because I can have both best of both worlds. And maybe, who knows, maybe I'm going to slowly leave the VFX industry because I kind of won't need to be on it anymore, you know?
It reminds me, it reminds me a bit of Colin Levy. He was in my podcast a few episodes back, which he got his whole kind of start as a director because he's also because he picked up a kind of a random tool that not a lot of people use, Blender. And he got to direct stuff for the Blender Foundation, and so because it's kind of an open source community, they got a lot of help from the community. Basically, this kind of open source productions. Where he's, I mean that's a great idea. I mean, and if it seems like you've already done it before,
I feel like there's a chance there because for me. I recently made a YouTube video about this, and I really believe that there are other methods of income and other methods of creating things. For me, especially
from 2 weeks ago, I think I saw it.
Yeah, you saw that video, maybe. Like so I feel like we're living in fantastic times. You know, like we're living in. You know, I wish I was younger. I wish I was 20 now, and I could start now when we are now living on this time because. It's fantastic, you know, you have like Kickstarter, you have Patreon, you have like YouTube, you have all these platforms which allows you to build an audience. And I feel like, you know, as long as you can get like about 1,000 people to 2,000 people that are following your work, you're going to be fine, you know. Right. And that's what I'm starting to understand now, that maybe perhaps instead of wasting my time doing commercials for some random company or commercials for some random client, maybe that's the time now for me to do commercials stuff for myself and for my audience because they follow me because they like my work. They follow me because they like my streams. And so if I'm doing my own work, it's even more genuine. And then it gives me the ability to share the assets and I can share the footage and I can give them the stuff as well and also teach them along the way. I kind of feel like now this is the perfect time to do this because people... I know I'm not after doing a film for being watched by a million people. If I have like a couple of thousand people watching, I'm very happy already. And I think that's where we live right now. We're living on this like kind of microclimate where people have micro audiences. I think that's what Twitch is all about. You know, like you have someone on Twitch earning a living and they have like, you know, 500 subscribers and maybe 2,000 followers. And that person makes a living from that. It's enough money from them for them to live. And they are creating things they like and they're just streaming and doing things. It's a lot of work, of course, but it also has other advantages, you know. Now that my YouTube channel is starting to become so big, I'm starting to have sponsors. I'm starting to have companies wanting to pay my channel so that I can promote certain things. And it starts to kind of like... grow and it starts to become a business of its own. So I'm definitely, you know, David, I'm definitely on a crossroads for sure. You know, like I've been working for 20 years, as I told you, like I could always go back to the mill at all, any times. You know, they always send me messages once in a while, like, oh, do you want to come back? Like, and I could always go back. You know, Framestore also always emails me and do you want to come back? And no. I at the moment, I'm kind of like, should I go back to production and you know, do these really cool films and really cool commercials and really high profile jobs, or I'm not 41, should I actually work for my jobs? You know, they're not as cool, but they are my jobs. You know,
yeah.
I feel like that's the feeling I'm having right now, and maybe it's a really big mistake. Maybe I should go back to the mill. Maybe I should have never left the mill in the first place. But
how do you define the difference between what you consider your job? Well, I mean, I know the difference. The difference is your job is clients come to you as opposed to going to the mill for the things, right? And so the same clients are probably not going to come to you for something they go to the mill for. But is that an actual scenario? Because I have clients who came to the mill first. I mean, of course, it was a very short endeavor when they got the bill or, you know, the quote. And then they came to me, and clearly, you know, it was never going to be a mill project. But
I've done that as well. I've even I'm very proud of actually even winning jobs against the mill, for sure. Like I still do productions jobs. I still do production, but what I'm seeing now is that this is the time for you to, like, this is the birth of multiple small companies, I think, you know, studios and companies that are made of 5 or 10 people. You know, like my company, we're only 5 at the moment, and we can grow and scale really easily. Like, we've had a cinematic a couple of years ago where we had to have 20 people on it, and we did. We got 20 people, and we did it remotely anyway. We have a very robust pipeline, which, by the way, my pipeline is nothing more than you know, a representation of what I used to do at the mill. So I think, if anything, I would always advise anyone to always, at least once in their lifetime, try to work in a big studio, because it will teach you so much, you know, about pipeline. It will teach you about deadlines. It will teach you about professionalism. It will also teach you how to work in a team. And the most important part, it will bring you a lot of network, a lot of contacts.
Yep,
and
important.
Still to this day, most of my clients are older clients I had at the mill, you know, because I was the head of department. I had a suite for myself at the mill, so I had clients all day long there for 8 hours. And so a lot of my clients these days are clients that I brought with me, you know. And a lot of the artists that I still work on my team, they are artists from the mill as well. So working in a big company really has a lot of advantages. And my pipeline is also very similar to the pipeline of the mill, minus the Redshift swap to Arnold, you know. So everything else is very similar. So I think, obviously, I could continue working as a VFX company. I could continue working on these jobs that I've been doing lately with cinematics and games. But my thing right now is that I'm starting to see that I can probably earn enough money from my Kickstarters, and I can earn enough money from my Twitch and my YouTube to actually leave production altogether and only do my own projects, which are production anyway, because if I do them, I'll give an example. The last Kickstarter that I did, which was for the Nuke composting course. My Nuke composting course is an ongoing project. You know, I've been building it for 2 years now. It has 150 classes already. It's about 80 hours long. You know, it's very long. It's very big. And because I have so much good relationships with the mill, I even managed to get footage from the mill into the course. So my students have footage from the mill to test and to try and to use. I also have footage from Deep Silver. I have footage from Ubisoft. I have, like, proper assets for people to use on their course. You know, so it's a professional course. But now I'm kind of, like, starting to look at my assets, and I'm kind of like, okay, now I want to have new assets. So I want to have some stuff done completely in deep composting. I want some stuff done in Aces. I want to have some new assets. So because I'm not at the mill anymore, I can't really get those assets anymore. But what I'm doing now is, the last time I funded, I picked up a bunch of money from that funding and I put it aside, and I basically said, okay, I'm going to hire my own VFX team, the team that I always use, you know, the VFX supervisor from the mill, the guy that used to be a composer at the mill, like these people, and I'm going to pay them a regular rate to work on these shots. And then the result of these shots, the CG, the composting, the editing, all of the results of these shots will become my new production shots for the next course I do.
Nice,
So that's what I'm kind of now starting to build, you know, where I get funding enough so that I can hire the people that are from the industry to make shots for a potential course. And along the way, my plan is to start making short films out of it. You know, so that's kind of my plan right now. And that's why I was saying, yes, maybe I'll leave production, but it's not really leaving production because I am going to be doing productions. It's just that they're going to be my productions.
That's, you know? Yeah. I mean, I think I love what you do, and I often think to myself, what if I, you know, started a Twitch channel and I just showed my screen as I'm working, because I'm also working on things that a lot of people could find interesting. And the obstacle is usually, for me, that I'm working on secret stuff that, the company that once, you know, that I'm working for probably doesn't want those things surfacing before they're ready.
Of course.
And I could be smart about it and record and wait until after the project comes out
to release that. Yeah.
But maybe I'm just, don't have that much foresight and I'm like, you know, just...
I think that's why, you know, that will never really work. I mean, the productions will, like, most of the time my clients either say yes or they say no categorically. And that's why I think that's why I made that video on YouTube. I really strongly believe that a lot of us kind of, we went into this industry, right? Because we loved films,
right?
We came into this industry because we wanted to be artists, we wanted to do films, and we wanted to be filmmakers. And along the way, we kind of forgot. And it's like we've been like very busy with making all these things and all these clients and all these projects. But I think sometimes we forget that we were supposed to be artists as well. So I feel like now is the perfect time for people to actually create their own things. And the only people that I see doing that on Twitch, for example, on YouTube, or concept artists, they do that a lot.
Right.
And drawing, and people doing drawings, and people, and they actually make a living out of it, especially with ArtStation and especially with making streams. But I kind of wish that there was more micro productions, you know,
right.
Because if you look at the productions then in Hollywood and the productions then in the world, there's only two types of productions. There's either like the 200 million project, you know, like which is like the Marvel movie, or you have like the really, really super cheap thing that kind of came from an independent studio and kind of it kind of was viral and became big.
Yeah.
There's nothing in between anymore, and I feel like we are the ones that need to step in to make this in between, especially with the advent of Netflix and the advent of Amazon Prime. And now is the time for us as creators to start making scripts, start to making pitches, and start to making low-budget productions.
Right.
Because the low-budget productions, I'm talking about productions, the ones that I used to see when I was younger, you know, the £5 million, like $5 million for Reservoir Dogs, or you know, $11 million for Pulp Fiction. It's unthinkable that it costed $11 million, you know?
Yeah.
Or even, like the other day, I was watching Machete from Robert Rodriguez. And Machete, which is quite recent, it's only 10 years old, that film costed $12 million. And I was like, how the hell did he even made it in $12
million?
Yeah. And it is possible, and I think we have platforms now to sell these productions. And it could be from a number of things. It could be sponsored by companies. It could be sponsored by Kickstarter, together with Indiegogo, together with streams, together with Twitch subscribers. Now I think it's the perfect time to create cool stuff and to create cheaper productions and really kind of basically revolutionize the model, because why do you really have to go through a big studio to become a director? I don't see it as a viable way to do
it
anymore.
True. I mean, I gotta say that for people who listen and say, well, wait a second, $12 million is quite a lot. Like, so it's not like I have it lying around in my.
Of course.
I made a feature for $550,000, and
yeah, you see,
and not that I have that lying around either. I mean, I had a distributor that came to me, and it's not like it's the best film. It's probably I think about it probably like you think about your karate film.
Yeah, exactly.
You're 18, and it's probably not that much better, but it's doable. I mean, and I did it in LA, you know, not even I did it in LA, and I had equipment that I got for, I think I did it in a, you know, I was lucky because at the time there was a lot of runaway productions left the city, and there's all this equipment just lying around not being used, so we were lucky to get a lot of things for dirt cheap. But it's possible, like, you know, and I think, and I know someone, I have a friend who did a film for way less, I mean, and self-finance an entire feature. So it's one of those things where it's like films. So, I mean, from my experience, from what I've seen, films have a way to come to being when people want to make them. You know, like money becomes secondary when you're already like, you know, set in motion and you have people behind you. You know, it'll happen even if it, you know, even if you have to do it over weekends and people do it for, you know, voluntarily.
Absolutely. And you see, I think this is the generation to do it. We are the people that know the softwares. We, you know, back in my time when I started, you would have to use, like, if I... Back in my time, like, you would have to literally be in a company to learn software because the software was only on that company, right. You know, or, you know, only the mill could have a flame suite, you know, because no one could afford have a flame suite because it was like $500,000 to buy the software. Now, you know, you can literally do it for free. Like, you can literally use Blender, you can use Neutron, and you're done. Or even Fusion. Fusion is free. Like, you can literally do the whole Hollywood type amazing production using completely free software from, and not to mention Unreal. Unreal is free for creatives.
Yeah.
It's not even, you don't even have to pay. So there's so much more now to do. Like, I wish I had it when I was younger, but back then I had to like pay. If like I, when I first started using Nuke, I bought a Nuke license. It costed me $10,000. You know, it was like, like just that license. Now I can obviously Nuke hasn't really changed price anymore, but you can now get alternatives which are cheaper. So I feel like if people want to make a film, now is the time, and they should just like not forget that they if they went to the industry because they like to be filmmakers, they should, you know, if we had more content going out, because there is the need to content. You see, we're now living on the microclimate where Netflix has like they have regional versions of everything, you know.
Yeah.
If you watch Netflix in Britain, you'll see one Netflix. But if you go traveling to Portugal, you'll see another Netflix. And if you go to Spain, you'll see another Netflix.
Yeah.
And this is so funny to do. Like, I've been traveling a lot these last years because of events. And I go to Spain and I see like Spanish productions in the Netflix, a bunch of them. I go to Portugal, I see a bunch of Portuguese productions. I go to Germany, I see a bunch of German productions. And so, although some of them kind of cross over and they go to other countries, obviously, if they are really good, but this is the time to do it you know, because these productions are smaller, they are more niche, they are also, because they are more niche and more cheap, they have the possibility to be more creative because more risks can be done.
Yeah.
You can risk things. You can maybe do, you know, like, you know, like I did back in the day, you can do a ninja film now, or you can do like the first, you know, let me give you an example. You can do the first gay ninja film, you know, like you can do those niche projects,
right.
Or you can do the first comedy about whatever it could be, you know, about some drunk somewhere. Like, all these things, the creativity becomes so much more flexible because you're not controlled by, you know, an IP or a big studio, or because all those companies are, you know, they are paying $200 million, they need to be sure the film is going to be successful.
And I think it's tough when you're fixated a bit, when people kind of who drew inspiration from big Hollywood pictures and the fact that they were like global phenomena, you know, like Jaws and Jurassic Park and Star Wars and you know, to kind of come to terms with the fact that the industry is changing. I mean, those movies are, there's fewer of them, and you have to, and when they are made, they're made nowadays in a much different way than they used to, I think. You know, it's enough to just see the latest blockbusters to see how...
I mean, they used to be independent movies, you know.
Yeah.
Like Jaws was an independent movie practically, and the budgets were minute, and they were super small, and those productions were pure filmmaking, you know. And I think sometimes we forget this, and everyone is always complaining about, oh, these superhero movies are so boring, oh, there's so much Disney Marvel everywhere. Well, it's up to you. You can make more, you can make other things,
right.
You know. And I think I really welcome Netflix on that sense. I thought Netflix have been revolutionizing cinema for sure. Like, they've been giving so much space for those directors that didn't really have a voice anywhere. You know, those directors that were losing their voices, especially because they couldn't really afford, they couldn't be picked up by a studio because the studios didn't want to risk $10 million to do a film, you know. And I feel like Netflix is in the perfect place for that because they can put the $10 million down because they are always going to recoup the cost because they have a subscription based. And I guess I go for full circle here again. It's the same when you're an artist. If you have some kind of following on Twitch or Patreon or on YouTube, you become like a subscription based thing as well. It's all about making content and making content from your creative mind, so, and also to have people that like to watch what you do, you know.
And to talk on that, I was kind of curious. Both, I wanted to ask you about Twitch and the fact that you don't only, you have two things that you share, as far as I know, maybe more actually. So you have a bunch of kind of series of, you know, showing you at work and dissecting your own shots. Sometimes you have showreel sort of commentary.
Yeah.
And you also have gaming, basically gaming streams where you you just play games and record yourself. How did that come about? Because that seems totally out of, you know, completely different. I was wondering if it's the same people who watch the other streams also watch the gaming stuff, or I mean, of course there's overlap, but I personally, I'd love to be doing that too, because I have no time for games. So I'm just fascinated by how did that come up? Like, when did you have the time for it? And
well, I only started streaming a year ago, but my YouTube channel started 5 years ago. It's going to be 5 years this year. And the YouTube channel started, you know, when I was doing my own productions and I was doing my cinematics for Square Enix, for Ubisoft, for all these companies, for Deep Silver. And because I was directing these trailers and cinematics, I was in a very privileged position where I could ask the client, you know, guys, do you mind if I do a YouTube video where I deconstruct this shot? You know, I think my audience, my students would love to see that. And I kind of started like that. And most of the games companies kind of said yes. I had a couple of them that said no, but most of them said yes, you know, because for them, you know, it's not their audience. And they know it's any publicity is good publicity. You know, if anyone is going to play the game, it's going to be even better for them. So that's why I think the success of my YouTube channel came from those deconstructions, where I was like opening real projects, like real jobs that I've done for these cinematics, and I would deconstruct them step by step, showing them how did we do this and how did we do that, and this here we had a little technique and here we had a little trick. And it kind of blew up my YouTube channel because of that, because there was no one else doing this content online. And I still don't think there's anyone doing this content, because a lot of times you get no from the client. The reason you get no from the client is most of the times people are in low level, you know, it's like you can't really be a composer and ask that, you know, because that you're not going to get it, you know.
It's also, I've been the lucky, levels. You have to ask your boss, you have to ask them, and they just don't want to do that,
Exactly. And because I was lucky enough to be either directing it or supervising it, I had direct contact with my client, so I could ask them, and, you know, some of them became my friends, you know, we would go out and have drinks, and it's easier for you to say, oh, by the way, I have a YouTube channel, do you mind if I do this? And they would say yes, and you know, some of them said no, of course, but most of them said yes, and I think I've been lucky with that. So that's kind of how it started. You know, my YouTube channel started becoming a deconstruction YouTube channel, and then slowly I kind of started doing other series. You know, I started doing like some tips and tricks on set. I started doing some tips and trips on Nuke as well. That's how I built my YouTube channel. And right now it's like very, very close to 30,000 subscribers right now. Which
29 which point is, it's, something. Point one,
yeah. So which is very small for YouTube, I know. Like YouTube is all to the millions and it's incredibly small. But for Nuke compositing and visual effects in general, it is incredibly big. Like I because if you look at really, for example, if you look at, for example, the Foundry's YouTube channel, they have like 70,000. So I'm already halfway through to the subscribers of the Foundry.
Yeah.
And I even have like more views on my videos than the Foundry has on theirs. So it's already, it has to do with the fact that it's a very niche market, and there's not a lot of people doing visual effects. People think there's a lot, but there's not. It's a very small market.
Can you attribute the rise in following to specific videos? Like which videos were the ones that kind of sort of you saw spikes?
I think that, the deconstructions were definitely my most famous videos. Although now my reviews on monitors are bigger because obviously that picks up other people. My biggest video for some reason is the lens distortion explain what a lens distortion is and how to film it. And that's my biggest video. I have like 60,000 views on it. But for some reason, I think it's because it collected people from other departments. Yeah. But the disconstructions were definitely the biggest thing. But now, what I'm doing on Twitch is different. You know, on Twitch, I'm doing multiple things. I've started doing Twitch a year ago. I used to watch Twitch all the time because I play a lot of games. I'm a big gamer, and so even when I was not working in the games industry, even when I was still in VFX, I've been playing games since I'm 6 years old. You know, and I've never really stopped. I've always continued playing games even to this day. Almost every day I play games. So I was following a lot of gamers on Twitch, and I started thinking, okay, it could be cool to do other stuff on Twitch as well. There's already people doing it. There's people doing modeling.
Right.
There's people doing ZBrush. There's people doing drawing. But no one really was doing VFX, for sure. So no one was doing Nuke. No one was doing editing. No one was doing those kind of things. And so I started doing streams a year ago, and I started getting a lot of people asking me, oh, can you review my show reel? Can you help me with my show reel? That's why I started doing the show reel reviews, and then I started doing the workshops in Nuke, and then I also started doing some book reviews, and because it's Twitch's games, I also play games on it. But obviously, my audience is very different. You know, like when I play a game, you know, when I'm doing a Nuke workshop, I usually have like 200 people watching, you know, live.
Right.
But if I'm playing a game, I might have like maybe 50 people. So I think from the VFX people, then it narrows down to just the people that are in VFX but also play games.
Right, yeah.
So I think it becomes smaller. But when I'm playing games on Twitch, it's just like a relaxing session. I'm just like playing games.
But we do Q&A,
but it's...
You're talking about live views, right? 250 people live. That's still a very decent number for live.
Well, for Twitch, it is like for creative streams. Usually, creative streams, you know, of people doing drawings, of people doing ZBrush or modeling or anything, it's really on the top end because usually you have some people doing maybe 300 views. That's the top artists on Twitch. Some people usually they do, you know, the biggest artists on Twitch do anything between 50 to 300.
Yeah.
And I'm always having at least 150. That's where I am at the moment. Sometimes I go to 200, sometimes I go back to 100. So it depends on the day, of course, but I already have I've noticed that I have at least 150 people that always show up. And so it's a considerable following in Twitch, and I've only been doing it for a year, and I have like about 300 subscribers, which is quite good for Twitch already for an artistic stream, you know. So it's definitely become something that I've really enjoyed. I'm doing it really because I'm enjoying it. I can tell you one thing, like I'm not earning enough money from YouTube, and Twitch don't pay almost anything, you know. They pay very little money. So yeah. I'm doing it because I love it. You know, I do YouTube videos because I love to do them and share with my community, and I do Twitch streams because I love talking with them and helping them. The biggest, like the from all those platforms, the two platforms that really give me more revenue is definitely Patreon and definitely Kickstarter.
Right.
Those are the two big ones where I have on Patreon, I have my biggest fans, which really support my platform. And then, of course, in Kickstarter, it's like a very niche market. You know, I have, like I said, 450 students, but my course is very, very advanced, so people pay a lot for it, you know. So it's because it's like a mentored course. So those are the two platforms that really are... I think if anyone here is listening and wanting to start doing these things, I would advise you to use YouTube and use Twitch as a promotion to something else. That's what I would advise you. So I would advise you to put YouTube videos up. Not for money, because you're never going to get it. Unless you're doing a video about a cat or doing a meme review, you'll never get it. So your YouTube video should be to build the brand of something else that you're going to sell. You know. So for example, let me give an example. Imagine you're a really good concept artist. Imagine you do beautiful concept art. You do beautiful drawings.
Yeah.
And imagine that you want to make a living out of your own work, and you want to do like a comic book, or you want to do maybe a board game or something. You should use your YouTube channel to promote your work, promote your drawing, and make a following, and then make a Kickstarter for your comic book.
Right.
And then those people on YouTube will go into the Kickstarter, and if you can get like 10% of those people to pay, you are good.
Yeah.
You know? So that's the way that it really works this way. I'm running all these things on the 10% level. That's how it usually works, you know. So
10% meaning 10% of the people that are watching you on YouTube would end up potentially...
Well, it's less, obviously it's less, but I'm talking about more about board games and about comic books and films. And
right, yeah.
If you consider, like, imagine that you have 100,000 subscribers on your YouTube channel, if you're a famous concept artist, you have 100,000 subscribers. If you can get, maybe 10% is too much, sorry. I would say, like, if you can get 1,000 of those people to pay you on Kickstarter for the comic book, you're going to be able to fund the comic book.
Yeah.
You know? So that's the way that I feel like it could be a way to go. For example, if you are, give you an example. Imagine if you are like a person that has good scripts and wants to direct stuff. Imagine that you can get maybe 2,000 people to pay for the short film. You probably could do the short film with maybe £20,000 or maybe £30,000, and then with some favors from other people. You know, and that could be the first one. And then the second one, maybe you already have the first Kickstarter, so it'll be easier to do the second one.
Yeah.
I think that's kind of, again, I keep saying this, it's the micro thing. It's not about big numbers, it's about micro numbers, but those numbers are enough to do certain things. So.
And I think there's something cool about, you know, I made a short film and I self-financed it, and I, you know, did not even try Kickstarter. And I did it For certain reasons. One is because I don't think I have enough, like, inherent following, because I don't have a YouTube mm-hmm. channel. And, you know, this podcast is great and people find a lot of value in it, but it doesn't attract a huge number of people. So I didn't think about it as potentially a big thing. Plus, I know I have friends who've done successful Kickstarter campaigns. I know how much work it is to push it.
Absolutely.
It's relentless. It's almost as hard as just like going out and working for the money.
It is. But you see, it's your thing. So it's almost like, yes, it's more work than working in production, but because it's your own project, you're going to work harder and you're going to work better.
And,
you know,
and the other advantage, I think, in it is that because you're putting that energy outside, trying to grab other people's attention, you're already creating some kind of captive audience. Like, people who spend money on your project on Kickstarter are not just, you know, people who are doing you a favor and you think about it like, oh yeah, now I have the money. These are people that are going to eagerly await the release of your film. Like, they want to, they want their money's worth back, you know?
Yeah.
And it's a good thing because...
I feel like a lot of people that I talk about, they say, oh, but, you know, why should I bother? You know, there's too many of us and there's too many Kickstarters, too many projects. But people fail to realize that the artistic community like ourselves, you know, VFX artists, 3D artists, concept artists, all of these departments from VFX and gaming, we're not that many, you know, like we can probably count ourselves by the millions, you know, and there are billions of people in the world, you know, so... Even if we, all of us, would start doing now short films and comic books, and it doesn't really matter because there is enough people that are not artists to actually buy our content. And I think that's why I'm so happy to live on the time that I live, because I think now we have a content-hungry society. You know, people, especially people are home and they really want to see things and they want to see shows and they want to see comic books and they want to listen to music and they all... I guess what I'm saying is, like, I think we should take more cues from the music industry. You know, if you look at the musicians, they make their music and it's their IP, you know, and then they make concerts and then they make money from the CDs a little bit, but then they make money from the vinyls and then they make money from the special editions and then they make money from especially the concerts, of course.
Yeah,
I think us as artists, you know, people that are 3D artists and modelers and concept artists and visual effects artists and composers, we should start learning to be a bit more like them. And we should focus our attention to make IP.
Yeah,
because I think that why would we spend 20 years working on Star Wars IP? You know, maybe get together and make your own IP.
Exactly.
And it will never be as big as Star Wars, but maybe it will be big enough to give you enough money to live and enough money to continue, and especially enough inspiration to become an artist and do better things and continue to evolve. You know, I just feel like Like, people forget that and the importance of IP. You even see that on companies. There is no... Like, this is why you look at companies like ILM and you look at companies like Framestore and you look at companies like Pixar. I know that they've been bought by other big, big corporates like Disney, but they were bought because they started working on IP. That's the key thing here, you know. They started working on their own things. If you look at Framestore, they are starting to work on their own productions, their own directions, and things that they direct themselves. This is really, I think, the future of these kind of contents, and we should ride that train as well, instead of all of us working for the people, I believe, you know.
Yeah, totally. But actually, to that point, I was wondering, because you say, as you say, you're still on the road to being able to be self-sustaining just from Twitch and, yeah, and those things.
Yeah.
Over the last 5 years since you've started, you know, kind of developing this this online presence, have you ever been to a place where you got too much normal work, where it basically was threatening to take you away from the time that you would need to be investing in YouTube mm-hmm. videos? And how did you manage that?
It happens all the time. It happens all the time. I'm constantly on that situation where I have too much work and I can't really focus enough on my course, or, you know, I've been like very bad at that. Sometimes I fail to deliver all the classes that I should have delivered, or
right.
I fail to deliver all the Patreon rewards that I should have done. So that happens to me all the time. And that's why I was telling you that it's a crossword for me. Like, I'm kind of like a crossroads. I'm kind of like debating to myself, I should just focus on one thing. Because it is a full-time job to do a YouTube channel, a Twitch stream, and to do a Kickstarter. It is a full-time job for sure. And obviously, you need to be careful because the production work is the reason why my channel is successful. And obviously, if I stop doing production work, I might lose momentum, because then I don't have production, which is why people came to my channel in the first place.
Yeah.
But as long as you can create production level productions, even if it's your own productions, as long as they look as good and they have the same pipeline as the real productions, then you are going to be fine with that. You know, that's the level of quality that you have. The bar has to be very high. If you're gonna make like a music video or a commercial that is gonna be specifically done just for your channel and for your followers, and it's gonna be like a project of love that you're gonna be giving away on a course or something, it has to look as good as any production that comes from the mill or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
So that's why I was saying that I would hire those people to do it, you know, because then it becomes just as good as those, you know.
Yeah. No. I mean, it's. It is definitely seems like a challenge that takes kind of mastering to be able to do.
It is, it is, yeah, it is. But I feel like, if anything, I know we've been talking about this for a long time, but if anything, I think people should start looking into their future, you know,
yeah,
of what should they be doing as their own thing. Personal, I guess a lot of people say these things, but personal projects are much more important, I think, than people give it credit for. And I think they are so important, not just for the development of your artistry, but also the development of your career, and also the potential contacts you might have from that personal work, you know. I think, if anything, people that are not doing personal work right now, they should start one right away, because they are going to be very, like, if you only work in production with nothing personal happening, the chances are is you're going to become a bitter old man, and you're never really going to leave that work,
yeah,
you know, ever. And that's going to become a problem in the future when you want to leave and when you become obsolete, you know.
Exactly.
So that's the thing, because we'll all become obsolete, you know. Obviously, there will always be younger people coming in and doing better and cooler stuff. And that's why you should always focus on having a strategy or a way out or other things, you know.
So for you, it seems like the next kind of step in your career, or the next big challenge, is to start creating your own original content that you're going to somehow intervene very carefully, very artistically with your current track of releasing courses and teaching mm-hmm. online and engaging your community, which I think is a great. I mean, I'm excited for you. I wonder what are you actively doing about it right now? Like, have you started like coming up with scripts, or do you already have scripts in your drawer?
Yeah.
And And what's like, how do you plan that, like kind of moving forward? If you think about it, it's in a year from now.
Yeah. So I don't, I've been slowly doing it for sure. Yeah. So the short film that I said I was still finishing, that's a short film I filmed with my students about 2 years ago. So that short film is a zero budget short film. You know, I did it with my students. We did it with the equipment we could find. We did it with the actors we could find. We did it on the city where the university is. So it's a very low budget. It's not very good. It's just a horror film that it's a short horror, short film that I enjoyed doing with them. And it was more about the process of doing it than anything else. So that one I'm doing right now. So I've already started doing it on Twitch. I'm actually comping it live on Twitch.
Oh, cool.
You know, as I go. And I'm going to be doing the conforming on Twitch, and I'm going to be doing the editorial on Twitch and in the grading as well. So it's going to be like a project. It's going to take me a year to finish because I'll slowly do it. And then I have my two CG leads that I have on my company. They're doing the CG. So the CG is going to be with deep compositing, with Aces, with everything. It's going to be in 4K. It's going to be with Houdini.
Nice.
It's going to be as it should from a mill production. Obviously, the film itself, the acting is not very good because it's from the students, and the locations are just the locations we found, you know, on the school, not the school, sorry, on the city where the school is. So obviously the film is a very limited film, but this is the first one, you know, it's right. The first one. So it's going to be the first of many, I hope. That's my plan, is to finish this one first. I have a script that I finished. Yes, I have a script of a sci-fi pilot that I would like it to become a TV show of like 8 episodes or something. And that one requires a bit more work because it would require certain shots to be in green screen. Mm-hmm. It would require some spaceships modeling. It would require some sets as well. I'm planning to do that one as a Kickstarter so I can fund it. And I'm planning to do that one together with some of the studios that I've filmed, you know. So yeah. I have filmed on a couple of motion control studios in the world, and I'm planning to do them with them as a partnership. So
nice.
That one is ongoing, you know. And
is it motion control or motion capture or both?
Motion control.
Motion control. Okay.
Obviously, that was my plan to start that one, to film that one soon. But obviously now with the coronavirus, I'm reflecting a bit that maybe
right.
I should maybe look into a full CG project right now, because right now I can't film anything, you know. So I have enough animators on my network, and I have enough animators on my company and enough CG artists to actually build something. It wouldn't be very different from the short. Like, I've done the biggest CG trailer I did was like 2 years ago. I did it for a mobile game called Heroes Arena, and it was like about 2 minutes long. And we had about 20 people on that job. So if I do a short film, it will probably be like 2 or 3 minutes long. It will probably be the same team that did that trailer, and it will probably be the same kind of look at that trailer as it has. So that's maybe going to be my next step, because now with the coronavirus, I don't think I'm going to be on set anytime soon. I don't think so.
Really?
You know, so
even
yeah.
Like, how long do you imagine before you're back on set? Or, of course, nobody
knows. I don't
knows,
think but. So, because I feel like, at least, for example, in Britain, like, they're discussing lockdowns until October. And yeah. That means it will be until next year. That, I mean, maybe we'll never go back to normal as well. I don't believe it's going to be that soon, because I don't think a vaccine will happen. Like, we've never had vaccines of anything. Like, if you look at other viruses,
yeah.
We don't have, man, we still have, like, HIV still doesn't have a vaccine. Like, right. How long has been that? I don't know if this is going to be that fast as people think. And so that's why I'm kind of thinking maybe full CG would be my route. And if it is full CG, it will be done as often as I usually do my shows, which I tend to not use mocap. I tend to use manual animation I have very talented animators on my team, and they are so good. And I think I can convey different feelings when I have a hand animation project. I like that a lot, you know. So,
I think I've seen in one of your breakdowns for the Walking Dead trailer that you've it seems like you've used some like homemade mocap.
On that one, yeah, but that one was like, that was just not, it wasn't really acting. That was just like a zombie walking around. So my head of CG, like the lead CG project, he basically used the Kinect and just captured himself with the Kinect. Yes. So that works fine, but
yeah. I did a recent mocap project just as a test. I mean, and the client was willing to take a risk of getting like crappy results anyway, with the iPhone with the iPhone X, you know, with the
It has the two cameras,
And it came out a bit uncanny, but for what it is, you know, like something that we recorded basically voice actors with an iPhone, we managed to make characters move their lips and talk on camera. It's not, I wouldn't say do it, because not, especially not for a film that you want to, you know, present you, but there is some promise there, especially with the emergence of Unreal 5 and Unreal Engine 5 and all the all the promise that it brings. I think that that's definitely like one. Every time I make a short film, I try to experiment with new technology that I haven't used before. My last one used machine learning. I did like a face swap film, and I think for me the next one is definitely. And before that, it was virtual reality, mixed reality with Vive track, with the camera tracked on using the Vive Vive controller, and the next one I'm pretty sure is going to be something with real time game engine. And I think I covered most of what I wanted to ask you. I mean, of course we could go for longer, but I want to give people a break. What I wanted to last thing I usually ask my guest is what's your social media handles, where can people find you online, of course.
Yeah,
I don't think you've even mentioned that it's called Hugo's Desk.
I know. I did a poor job of presenting myself. Yes, I did.
And do you? And is it also the name of your company, Hugo's Desk?
No, it's not. No. My company doesn't have an online presence. Like I'll explain really shortly about that. So. Yeah, so I don't have an online presence yet because I'll be very honest. As soon as I left the mill, I went to a project right away, and I've never stopped until now, until the coronavirus. Wow. So I never had the time to do a website or to even do a showreel or to even do anything to promote my company, because when I left the mill, I already had a job, and then I had another one, and then another one, and it never stopped until right now when I'm finally... It's been 5 years, and it's the first time I don't have a job. Like, I don't have a project. So... And so now I'm looking into it. I'm looking into making a website. I'm looking into making a showreel finally, since I've never done a showreel for it. I guess it's good news, because that means I never had to work look for work, you know, great. Which is good news. But I'm still debating if I'm going to actually do it, because I don't think I want too much work. Because again,
sounds like
I'm so focused with YouTube, and I'm so focused on Twitch and Kickstarter. But I'm still debating. But yeah, the company is called the VFX Bureau. You know, just like the FBI, it's the Visual Effects Bureau. That's the name of the company. I bought the domain, I bought all those things, but I've never really made an online presence. But most of my clients and the people know me as Hugo Guerra, and they find me from my website. I have a website. You know, if you want to see my work, just go to Google and you just put hugoafenguerra.com. That's my website. That's where I have my latest productions that I've done. The last project that I have there is the Vermintide 2 trailer that I directed, which is a live-action trailer with miniatures and motion control. I was very happy that just yesterday I found that I won two awards with that project. So I won two Telly Awards again, so I was very, very happy with that.
It's very beautiful, and I saw some breakdowns of how you did it. It's really interesting and nice kind of combination of practical and digital. Yeah. And
I'm very, very proud of that job. So I just won the Telly Award for director, and I won the Telly Award from the audience. So
nice.
That means the project was the voted from the audience, which was really nice. I always like that award, because that's the award you want to get, you know.
Oh yeah, totally.
Because that means people liked it, you know. So you can go to hugoafenguerra.com to see my work, and then Hugo's Desk on everything else. You know, it's Hugo's Desk on Twitch, it's Hugo's Desk on YouTube, it's Hugo's Desk altogether. It's Hugo's Desk on YouTube, Hugo's Desk on Twitter. Like, I have Hugo's Desk across the board on all the social platforms. But you'll find me 3 times a week. I'm streaming at 4 o'clock UK time every Tuesday, Thursday, and Sunday. And I do showreel reviews, portfolio reviews. I do Nook workshops. I do book reviews, and I play some games on Twitch. On YouTube, I launch a video per week. Often they are either short snippets of Twitch or they are bespoke videos that I make specifically for YouTube. And I try to launch one video per week. I try. Sometimes I fail, of course. but yeah, that's my social media. I'm sure you can put the link on the
description. Yeah, I will. And I'm just curious, as a last anecdote, what's the most exciting across all those things? You don't have to, one per each. Just kind of one new thing that excites you. Is it a game or some video that you're working on or something else? What right now kind of the top of your...
Yeah, so from the videos I'm making, you mean?
Or the games that you're about to play or have played?
So from the videos that I'm going to make, I'll do it two times then. The videos I'm making, I'm really looking forward to launching two videos that I've been working for a long time. So... maybe too much long time. So I'm currently doing a full professional review of the new Mac Pro that you see on the background here, because I feel like there's no YouTube video from a professional point of view. There's just YouTubers talking about the computer,
Yeah.
So I've been doing that since I bought the machine. I bought the machine in December, so I've been doing that for 6 months now. Oh, wow. And I have everything from using it in Nuke, using it in Maya, using it with rendering. Like I've been using it with Windows, using it with Mac OS, really running down different graphic cards, checking how it works. It's a full review. So I've been working on that for several months, nice. And it will be out soon, I hope. The other video that I'm really looking forward, that I've been working on it for the last month, is a video about why you should work from home. And I think that's a video that has been... That is a video that I'm doing for a long time as well, because like you said, I've been working from home for 5 years. I know now everyone is working from home, but I want to give my opinion and my rundown of why you actually should and how does it work, and I'm going to be showing how that works.
Right.
So those are the two next videos that I'm going to drop on YouTube as large videos. I usually do a large video per month, and then every week I have the other ones, the small ones from Twitch. Then in terms of things that are coming up, man, I'm just waiting for Last of Us Part 2. That's the only thing I'm waiting for.
Okay.
that game is the biggest game that is going to come out this year. It's going to be out in the 15th of June, and I can't wait to play it. And I'm not really playing any games right now. I'm just waiting for that game to come out. I can't wait to play it.
I haven't played the first one, but I'm so far behind. I want to play Alex. I don't know if you've played Alex in VR.
I haven't played it yet, but I know. I haven't played it yet. I don't have a VR headset to play it yet. I only have a PlayStation VR headset, and it doesn't really. It's not compatible with the PlayStation VR headset. So, that's the game that I'm most looking forward. I'm sure it's going to be probably just like the Part 1. Last of Us Part 1 was when it was by far the best game of the generation, and now I'm sure this will be the biggest game of the generation.
That's great. That's great to hear. And a bonus question. I know that Hugo's desk is very famous. Your backdrop is really, is very familiar. and I've also seen pictures of the front end or what's in front of you, which is six screens. It's really crazy. I'm going to post a picture of that on the podcast page, because it's really inspiring to watch. And a lot of people, I'm sure, are drooling over that.
I just did a video about that, actually. I just did a video. It was a webinar for BenQ, which I'm going to add it to my YouTube channel as well, which I basically explain
what
all of it
is,
and explain. Yeah, because people are kind of, why do you have all this? And there's a reason. The reason is because this is actually a triple setup. I have it as a compositing station, but also an editorial station and a grading station.
Right.
So obviously I live in London, so my space is limited. So instead of having three stations, I only have one merged in one, and that's why there's so many things here,
And so just a quick kind of glimpse, not literally glimpse, but what's outside Hugo's desk? What is your rest of your place look like? What do you take pride in the most beyond what's obviously the confinement of what everybody knows you for, which is your desk?
What do you mean, like the rest of my house? You mean?
Yeah, I don't know. Do you have a favorite plant, or do you have a pet, or
I do. Yes, I have a dog and two cats, and I love them, and we walk around all the time with them. And they are already very old. They are 15 years old.
Oh wow!
They even my dog. They came from Portugal. They're all abandoned. They were abandoned when they were babies, and we found them on the street. I have those three pets, which are biggest love of my life as well. And then, of course, I'm married. I have my wife as well, Anna, for the last 5 years, I've been working from home. So we, of course, are both home as well.
Yeah.
Well, I have a side project that I've been doing with her for the last 2 months. I've released... Anna is a really good cook. She's really good. And we are both vegetarians. And so Anna just released a YouTube channel just for vegan and vegetarians. And I've been helping her film it. And I've been helping editing it and grading it. And,
oh, nice.
And she does the cooking and I film it. And so we just launched that YouTube channel. It's very small. You know, we only have like 150 subscribers so far. It's very, very small. And it just started. But that's kind of like an extra thing I do with her.
Yeah.
We share a love for filmmaking, so we, you know, on my living room I have a projector and we watch movies all the time, and I have like a collection of over 1,000 Blu-rays, you know.
Wow.
So it's because I've never been a digital person at all on these things. It's not because I love digital, the way of you buying a game digitally and way of you buying a film digitally. I think it's awesome. And that's, you know, I watch a lot of things and watch music as well, but the reason I still buy Blu-rays and the reason I still buy 4K Blu-rays is for two reasons. Like, one of them is because the quality is still better. You know, like, if you have a 4K Blu-ray, you're running a 100 megabyte bandwidth stream.
Yeah.
And if you watch a 4K stream on Netflix, you're lucky if it gets to 20 megabytes. So the banding is worse, the quality is worse, you don't even see the grain on the footage. So if you watch a Blu-ray 4K, still the best way to watch it. And my projector is 10-bit, you know, so you can really watch it really well. So you can watch it in HDR and everything. So that's one of the reasons. Mm-hmm. The second reason, of course, is all the audio commentaries and all the behind the scenes. Because that, unfortunately, is not translating into the digital world, which is a shame.
It is, you know? It is, yeah. And I think also it's great to have something physical that you own that you know is like
it is,
part of
it
your...
It is. Obviously, it's a pain to move
right.
houses because it's 1,000 cases, you know, like, and together with my 1,000 cases of games as well.
Oh, yeah.
So because I also have physical games, but nothing beats... I was very happy to see that Disney Plus lately, they've been actually putting behind the scenes of The Mandalorian as a show.
Yeah.
I really hope they start putting audio commentaries and other stuff as well. I just feel like there's been a lost thing in the translation here. Because why can't they just put an extra stream? Because they have the streams for the different languages. They could just put another stream for the audio commentary.
Yeah.
I don't really understand why we lost that. And that is still one of the biggest reasons why I still will continue to buy Blu-rays. Sometimes I even buy DVDs because of that. I'll give an example. Just recently, I bought this DVD, which is Splash.
Yeah.
And the reason I bought it on DVD is because the Blu-ray version has been edited and the Disney Plus version has been edited. So they basically removed Darren Allen. You know, there's several moments where she's naked.
Really?
And they removed that from the Blu-ray and they removed that from the Disney Plus version.
Huh.
And still this DVD, which is very old, it's from 97. This DVD is still the only version that has an audio commentary from Ron Howard. So I still buy DVDs because of that. Yeah.
Well, that's brilliant. I mean, great great advice all around. I'm glad I asked you about that. And thank you so much for your time. And good luck.
It was a pleasure. It was a pleasure. I hope your audience enjoyed our conversation. I know I talked too much, and I know it was very long.
No, I'm sure
that.
I have, and it's really, you know, really excited for you for the next, you know, for the next sort of mashup of that you're trying to put together of, like, you know, things that you love doing and your own creative aspirations and your, you know, following and your teaching and the fact that that you inspire others. And I also love the fact, just mentioning for a second, that your last few videos were also talking about not just filmmaking and visual effects and compositing, but also about doing exactly those other things, you know, like thinking outside of the box and the immediate sort of goals that some of your students have, and thinking beyond about developing their own voice and developing their own online presence and trying to think 10 years, 20 years ahead as opposed to just 2 years and, you know, 5 years ahead.
Exactly.
So you're doing a great service, and you're one of the gurus out there, which is, you know, remarkable. And, you know,
being too kind. Thank you so much for that.
Great. Well, I had it was an honor, and thank you.
Cool. Thanks so much, David.
All right. Cool.